Hello, everyone, and welcome. My name is Eric Franzen, and I'm stepping in for Shannon Kemp while she is on vacation this week. We would like to thank you for joining the current installment of the monthly DATAVERSITY webinar series, Real World Data Governance with Bob Seiner. Today, Bob will discuss writing data governance policies and procedures. Just a couple of points to get us started. Due to the very large number of people that attend these sessions, you will be muted during the webinar. If you would like to chat with us or with each other, we certainly encourage you to do so. Just click the chat icon in the upper right-hand corner of your screen to activate that feature. For questions, we will be collecting them via the Q&A module that you will find in the bottom right-hand corner of your screen. We will collect those throughout the presentation and get to as many as we can following the end of Bob's talk. Or if you'd like to tweet, we encourage you to share highlights or questions via Twitter using hashtag RWDG. As always, we will send a follow-up email to all registrants of today's webinar within 2 business days containing links to the slides, the recording of this session, yes, we are recording, and additional information requested throughout the webinar. Now, please allow me to introduce you to our speaker for today, Bob Seiner. Bob is the president and principal of KIK Consulting and Educational Services and the publisher of the Data Administration Newsletter, which you can find at tdan.com. Bob has been a recipient of the DAMA Professional Award for significant and demonstrable contributions to the data management industry. Bob specializes in non-invasive data governance, data stewardship, and metadata management solutions. And with that, I will give the floor over to Bob to get today's webinar started. Hello and welcome, Bob Seiner.
Good afternoon, good morning, I guess it depends on where you are. Hi, Eric, it's good to have you here. Great to have you filling in for Shannon. Looking forward to this webinar. You know, the Real World Data Governance series has been going on for many years, and I'm looking forward to keeping it going. Got lots of great subjects to talk about. As you mentioned, we're going to be talking about about writing data governance policies and procedures. You know, oftentimes in the webinar series, I talk about subjects that I am really, really passionate about, that I really think are going to be absolutely necessary in order to be successful with a data governance program. Writing data governance policies isn't necessarily one of those subjects that I feel that, you know, that it's absolutely necessary to have a data governance policy. So I'm going to raise a bunch of questions throughout this webinar about, you know, we'll talk about what goes into a data governance policy, but why it's necessary, why it might be right specifically for your organization. So I'm really glad to have a lot of people on the line today and hopefully provide a lot of good information for you folks about whether or not you need a data governance policy, what goes into a data governance policy, what the data governance procedures look like, and what goes into making making procedures successful through the governing of those procedures. Just a couple quick reminders before we get started. I want to let you know about the upcoming webinar, the third Thursday of each month, as Eric mentioned. On March 17th, I'll be doing a webinar called The Data Model as a Data Governance Artifact. The data modeling webinars that I do as part of this Real World Data Governance series seem to be extremely popular. And a lot of people are talking about data modeling as being a past science, and there's a lot of people that are talking about it being reinvigorated in a lot of organizations. And the data model is becoming a very important part of data management in a lot of organizations. We're going to talk about the data model specifically as an artifact that will benefit and add value to your data governance program. So I'm looking forward to having that webinar next month. And real quickly, just a couple of quick reminders. I want to remind you about the book that I wrote and that was published back in September of 2014 called Non-Invasive Data Governance, The Path of Least Resistance and Greatest Success. Also direct you to the kikconsulting.com website where you can find out a lot of information about non-invasive data governance. also wanted to share with you a couple other DATAVERSITY events that I will be involved in. Upcoming in April will be the Enterprise Data World Conference, which is always a fantastic conference. I'll be doing an advanced data governance tutorial during that event. Also, the Data Governance and Information Quality Conference, which is a DATAVERSITY event along with DevTech International. I will be doing two sessions there. One is assess your existing data governance program, and that will be a tutorial. And then I will also talk about data governance, privacy, and the Internet of Things in a shorter session. So hope you'll be able to make it to San Diego, either in April or in late June or early July, and hopefully we will see you there. A couple other quick reminders, as Eric mentioned, the Data Administration Newsletter. I do that in a partnership with DATAVERSITY. They are the producers of the publication. It's a monthly publication. If you're not familiar with it, please go out and take a look at it. A lot of great content from a lot of great authors, articles, columns, features, blogs, a lot of those types of things that'll keep you up to date on the data management activities going on presently. And final reminder is that just a couple days left to be able to take advantage of the early bird registration for the non-invasive data governance class that I will be holding in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania at the Sheraton at historic Station Square. It's a two-day public class. Please contact me if you're interested in more information about non-invasive data governance and how to register for that class. So how I typically kick off these webinars is I talk about the abstract real briefly, and then I jump into the content for the webinar. The abstract for this session specifically talked about data governance policy really being a guide to making decisions and delivering rational outcomes pertaining to data in your organization. The key word here is outcomes. I mean, you're finding that in a lot of different industries that people are looking for outcomes and results from putting programs into place. So a data governance policy is really that guide to making those decisions and delivering those rational outcomes. Really, data governance delivers a formal way for us to get to those types of outcomes. You know, when we think about writing policy and writing about associated procedures or procedures that are associated to that policy, you know, typically those can be a backbone and can be paramount to the success of our program. So that's what we're going to talk about today. If a data governance policy is right for your organization, if it is right, what are the things that go into writing a good data governance policy? What are some of the procedures that we need to focus on when we're starting with data governance? As usual, I'm going to share with you a bunch of the templates and tools that I use with the clients that I work with to help them to move their data governance programs forward. So I hope that you'll find value out of the things that I share with you today. Now, basically, we're going to talk about the components of data governance policy. We're going to focus on something that's really important called data governance principles, and there are four primary principles that I'm going to discuss with you that if we can get our management to say that these principles are important to our organization, that and we can get them to stand behind it, whether it's through policy or some other means, that it's going to really be a demonstration of support for governance in your organization. I'm going to share with you verbiage and diagrams that you can use to include within your data governance policies. We'll talk about why a policy may be necessary for your organization, and then we'll go into some details about the processes and procedures to support the data governance policy that you do put in place. So first things first, before we get started, I'd like to try something a little bit different here. Okay, by show of hands, for all you people out there that are listening to the webinar, by show of hands, you know, how many of your organizations have a data governance policy? A policy that is specifically focused on data governance. If you do, and I'm seeing that it's interesting because I really didn't expect a whole lot of people to raise their hands during the webinar, but there are a lot of people that are saying that. You know, so if you're one of those that is raising your hand, please share with me, and I will be glad to share with everybody, you know, what you have a data governance policy for, the reason why you have a data governance policy. I'd be very interested if the things that I'm going to share with you today are similar to the things that you include within your data governance policy. So that's very interesting to see so many people raise their hands. I guess data governance policies are very popular in organizations. So we'll talk a little bit more about that as we go through the session here as well. So basically, what is the purpose of having a policy in the first place? Okay, so typically policies are written and then they're approved and they're intended to influence and determine decisions, actions, and other matters associated with, well, whatever it is that your policy is there to put in place. So we know that we need to have it written well. We need to have it approved. We need, and it's got to have some intentions, and that those intentions can be to influence and determine decisions and actions that are associated with our data governance program. So what's the purpose of specifically having a data governance policy? Well, if we use the definition that I just shared on the previous page, you know, it's basically, it's written and it's approved and intended to influence and determine decisions, actions, and other matters that are associated with putting your data governance program in place. I've asked several of the organizations that I've worked with, do they need a policy? What would they use a policy for if they would have such thing as a data governance policy, or if they don't already have a data governance policy? And here are some of the things that they shared with me. Now, one of the first things is that it really spells out what data governance is for the organization. We need to have that definition. Is it necessary to have a policy in place in order to have to spell out what data governance is? Well, it really depends on your organization. But if we're going to make it formal, it may be good to kind of spell out what your governance program is going to be and why it's important and why it's necessary in something like a data governance policy. You know, it may be, and in some organizations, the policy basically spells out that they even have a data governance policy, or that they even have a data governance program. I'm sorry. That the fact is that people don't know about. So one of the best ways to be able to communicate with people in the organization is to have a policy that states that we have a data governance program. In some organizations, they think that data governance, the policy should spell out how it works, or who has responsibility, or who supports the program. You know, those are all really good things, and the question becomes, are those typically included within a policy in your organization? If they are, then let's write a policy that answers all of these questions, or spells out all of these things that are listed on this page. Now, we may spell out what governance will be applied, how governance is going to be enforced across the organization. There's a lot of purposes to having a data governance policy, or there's a lot of purposes to spelling out the things that I've listed on this slide here. The question really becomes is it necessary to have a data governance policy in your organization that spells out these things, or are there other mechanisms that you have to be able to share and discuss this type of information with people in your organization? So we're going to look at this question two different ways real quickly before we kind of go into what makes up a data governance policy. So the first question is, does your company or do you require a data governance policy? And if you answer that question yes, you know, the chances are that your organization is fairly policy-driven. That the precedence is that we will have a policy for our organization that spells out what data governance is and all those things that I shared for you on the prior slide. You know, one of the things that data governance policy does is it demonstrates that you have the senior leadership support for data governance. If you've attended previous webinars of mine, you'll know that one of the very first best practices that I talk about is that senior leadership will support and sponsor and understand what you're doing with data governance. Well, if they sign a policy, typically your senior leadership's not going to sign a policy unless they have some thought about demonstrating to the organization that they support what goes into that policy. So we need to raise the level of support, sponsorship, and understanding of our senior leadership to have a policy that they stand behind and sign is often a very good thing for the organization. You know, oftentimes you require a policy because it outlines who's responsible and how we're going to enforce the things that we're putting forward in the policy. So in some organizations, the answer to that question of do you require a data governance policy is going to be yes. But in some organizations, that answer is going to be no. You know, our organization is not policy-driven, or our senior leadership demonstrates their support to us in other ways. You know, they don't like the fact that everything needs to be drawn by a policy, so they say that guidelines work better. Well, if you look up a definition of what a policy is, they use the word guideline to define what a policy is. But some organizations will say that guidelines work better. And so we're going to enforce these rules through the guidelines that we put in place. Some organizations will say, no, we don't require a data governance policy because we already have policies in place. We have policies in place for information security, for privacy, for regulations and compliance protection, sharing quality. You know, you may already have a tremendous number of policies that are associated on governing your data. And they may not be called data governance policy, but they are policies that are focused on different aspects of governing your data. And I think most people will agree that data governance has a lot to do with information security and privacy and regulations and quality and all of those things that are listed here. So the organizations that say, no, we don't require a data governance policy, you know, they're probably asking the question of, now, what will a data governance policy add on top of these policies that we most likely already have in our organization? And it's something in the data governance policy that's not addressed by those previous policies. So there are questions as to whether or not a policy is going to be necessary within your organization. If you say, yes, a policy is absolutely necessary, there are certain key things that need to be included within that policy. You know, oftentimes there will be an introduction statement, a policy statement. What I'm going to focus on here in a couple minutes is the data governance principles, the things that we, if we can get our senior leadership to stand behind the principles that I'm going to define, that really becomes the main piece of what goes into your data governance policy. You know, obviously we need to be able to say who has responsibility, who's there to support it, how are we going to enforce it, but we need to have some principles that will become the guidelines for us to put our data governance program in place. So I'm going to share with you four key principles. I've talked about them before briefly. I'm going to talk about them in a little bit more detail today. And then we're going to talk about data governance dimensions here and what are the different things that we can put in place to measure the effectiveness of data governance, to measure the effectiveness of the policy that we're putting in place. So without further ado, we're going to kind of jump into these different components of a data governance policy. So one of the things that we know that we want to outline in a data governance policy is a purpose. What is the purpose? You can use from the previous slide that had the little redheaded guy working at his desk writing down the different things that data governance policy was going to spell out. You can use those items as part of your purpose. So I state here, the data governance policy is designed to manage the creation, transformation, and usage of data and related information owned by or in care of the company. Okay, that's a pretty generic statement when it comes to the purpose of a data governance policy. So a couple other example purposes could be that this policy directs the development of common data definitions, standards, requirements, and processes in the organization. That's a pretty major task if we're really going to direct the development of these common things across the organization. That's a big issue for a lot of organizations that have data defined numerous different ways in different definitions across the organization. Another example purpose could be that this policy directs the enforcement of lines of authority and decision-making when it comes to the data. I highlighted the last bullet on the screen on purpose because it is something that is very near and dear to me with a present client that I have. You know, it assures that the principles that we define as part of the policy, that they're fully implemented within the organization. And again, having the signature or having the backing or the support of senior leadership tells us that this is important enough. Now the next question is going to be, how are we going to govern the data effectively within the organization? Well, if you ask me, well, the first thing I'm going to tell you is, you know, be non-invasive in how you implement your program because it seems to interrupt the culture or interrupt the processes of the organization less if you are less invasive or less threatening to the culture of the organization. So we know that we have to have an introduction. We need to have a scope statement within the policy. So, for example, here's just another generic one. This policy applies to all employees, contractors, temporary employees, you know, consultants, agents, you know, of the company, whoever the company or the organization is. Example scopes, you know, the policy applies to all data that's managed. This second bullet here should probably be highlighted in red because, again, a recent client of mine is putting a policy in place and a statement from their CEO that states that all PII data and PHI data that is handled by people within the organization must be protected. And so that's basically the focus of their data governance program, is to protect PII and PHI data. You know, again, personally identifiable information or personal health information. Another example of the scope could be, this policy applies to all internally managed data, excluding, you know, certain data that is not in scope for whatever you're doing, whether it's a pilot or a proof of concept within your organization. Your scope may evolve over time, but we know we need to define the scope of the data that is going to be embraced by data governance as we put data governance into place. Violations, what happens if somebody does not follow the rules or the guidelines that are set up for the data? The last bullet on this slide here is really important, that violations of the policy are considered breaches of trust and that they can result in disciplinary action. You know, that's not something that is common to organizations these days, but if somebody breaks the rules and shares data when they shouldn't share data, or they do something that basically goes against things that are defined as policy of the organization, there has to be some level of repercussion. And so just defining or spelling out what the violations are for going against policy may be something that you put within the policy itself as well. So basically, I talk about putting together a data governance policy statement, so something that represents the policy to the organization. And here's an example. So it is a policy of our company to require that all data defined, produced, and used by or in care of the company be governed as a corporate asset through defined governance standards and procedures. Again, pretty generic, but that is a purpose statement. That is a data governance policy statement that could be used if you tweak it a little bit to things that are very specific to your organization. And again, kind of coming back to those principles that I mentioned earlier, data governance policy will be implemented to formalize how people of the company behave. And that's really what we're doing, is we're governing people's behavior that is consistent with the defined data governance principles that are represented on what people have said to me they call the graphic. So what does the graphic look like? And again, if you're somebody who is familiar with the real world data governance webinar series, you've probably seen this this diagram several times. You know, basically this outlines what went into a client's data governance policy several years ago. They said, we need to have a policy statement, and that is, and let's see if I can get the handy pointer here, that is what you see on your left-hand side of your screen, is we need a governance policy statement. We need something that says what the purpose of the program is, what the violations are, all of the things that I laid out before you. We also need a way to be able to measure the success of the program. And how are we going to do that? What we are going to do is we are going to start by defining several principles. We don't want too many principles. We don't want too few principles. You know, we want a just right number of principles that we can get our senior leadership to stand behind. And if we can follow those principles and we can outline what those principles are through our data governance policy, that's even better. So what we're going to do is for the next couple of minutes is we're going to focus on those principles that are right down the middle of this diagram. So if you notice something that's neat about this diagram, that each of those core principles has kind of a talking point or a statement associated to it that makes it real for people within the organization. So we may say that data must be recognized as a valued asset, that we must have clearly defined accountability, we must follow the rules. Those things are sound very strict and very determined. But if we tell the organization that we want to move from my data, from people having their own versions of the data, to kind of an organizational version of the data, or that data governance is everyone's responsibility, or that we always want to get it right, or we want to avoid risk and compliance issues, that makes the policy statements, the principal statements down the middle of this diagram, even more digestible for people across the organization. So I'm going to spend the next couple of minutes talking about each of these four principles and how they will be very important to putting a data governance policy into place. So we're going to talk about these principles, how data governance, and this really goes back to how data governance is defined for our organization. And so I rarely do this. Do I put in the middle of the slide that this is a very important slide? And the things that I talk about on the next several slides are important as well. But again, if we can get our senior leadership to support and sign off on the fact that each of these principles are the way that we want to act as an organization when it comes to governing data, we have now have a way of being able to now open the door to be able to tell them how we are going to do this across the organization. I'm not going to be able to address all of those things in the 45 minutes to 50 minutes that I have on the webinar today, but you know, we want to understand what, at least what those core principles are, that we can get our senior leadership to back them, then we really are making great strides towards getting them to understand that data is important and that data governance is important in our organization. So let's go through each of these four, and you know, I'd be curious as to whether or not, how these compare to the principles that you say that you put into your data governance policy, or whether you even have principles that you use as part of your data governance policy. And the first one is one that we hear all the time. It is that data governance, or the data, I'm sorry, is recognized as a valued and strategic enterprise asset. Okay, people have been talking about data as an asset for many years. You know, the fact is that data can have a positive value for the organization, or it can have a negative value for the organization. Now, I've even seen organizations that have attempted to put data on their balance sheets. So I think we all know about some of the positive values that data can have on the organization. You know, we can make better decisions. We're protecting the data. People know what the system of record is for the data. You know, they can get to data quickly, that we can control access and how we share that information. Those are all positive things that can come from governing data or managing data as an asset. Well, what are some of the things that we want to think about when it comes to negative value? If we don't get the data right to the people who are making these key decisions for our organization, that data has a negative value. Or if we don't explain to each and every person in the organization that handles PII data or PHI data the rules associated with protecting that PII data, then that data can have a negative value to the organization. If somebody shares it in the wrong way and that information becomes public, it can be very damaging to your organization. So when we're talking about recognizing data as a valued and strategic enterprise asset, that means that the definition of that asset, the definition of the data, must be governed. We must have the appropriate people involved at the right time in putting good definition to the data of the organization. The production of the data, the production of that asset must be governed. You know, the people that are on the front lines and entering data in need to know that, you know, we want to be very certain that the data is accurate as it's being entered in, whether it's through a system, something that prevents them from adding wrong values, or that they rearrange values or they leave out values, that the production of that data must also be governed. You know, the fact is that the usage of the data, we all understand that the usage of the data must be governed, and there's rules associated with how people can and cannot use data across the organization. So the first principle is core, is kind of the core to everything that we're talking about here. Data is recognized as a valued and strategic enterprise asset. If we can get our senior leadership to agree to that and agree to the following principles, then we're making a great step towards towards putting a governance program in place. And it, again, as I mentioned it before, it opens the door for us to be able to tell them, how are we going to govern the definition of data? How are we going to govern the production and the usage of data? And obviously the answer to that is we're going to take a non-invasive data governance approach. Now, we're going to take a data governance approach that best fits the culture of our organization. So the second principle I want to share with you is that accountability for data is clearly defined, recorded, and enforced. Okay, so we know that data is an asset. Now we're going to identify who in the organization defines data, produces data, and uses data. And in the past, I've done webinars on everybody is a data steward, get over it. You know, the idea of being non-invasive in the approach to data governance is that if a person has a relationship to the data, then they need to be held formally accountable for that relationship to the data. And almost everybody in the organization has a relationship to data in one way, shape, or form. they're either defining data as part of their job or producing or using data as part of their job. So we need to find a way to help them to understand how they can be responsible about the way they define, produce, and use the data. Again, the whole idea of the accountability is really based on a person's relationship to data. And one of the tools I'm going to share with you in a little bit, something I call a common data matrix that I've used before, helps to outline those relationships between people and data across your organization. So, you know, I said everybody is a data steward, get over it. The fact is that in a lot of organizations that are following a non-invasive approach, they agree that people need to have formally defined and clearly defined, recorded, and enforced accountability for the data. And then we need to educate them on what that means and how they can go about following that level of accountability for that relationship to the data. The third principle is that data must be managed to follow internal and external rules and regulations. And you know, the interesting thing about this principle is that it's a no-brainer. Now, this principle is not optional for people. You cannot opt out to external rules and regulations. They say to the government, yeah, we understand the rule, but we're not going to follow it. Or we understand that we've got PII data and we're not going to protect it. That's not an option for organizations. So really, principle number three is a no-brainer for organizations. It is data must be managed to follow internal and external rules and regulations. You know, there are internal rules for things that business rules for how you handle data across the organization, and then there's the law. And the fact is that if we don't make the law digestible to people in the organization, they understand what the rules are and what they can and cannot do with the data, then how can we expect them to follow the law? So rules and regulations must be clearly documented, so somebody in the organization has the responsibility for documenting it, taking those rules and making them digestible for people, making them understand and see themselves in the rules so they understand if they can or cannot do a specific activity with the data that they use in the organization. That they use makes them a steward, so they need to make sure that they follow the rules associated with that data. We need to communicate the rules to people. We need to have a way to be able to enforce the rules. We're not going to have people standing by every printer to make sure that PII data that was printed out is then turned over to a person. You know, we can't enforce it that way, but we can enforce it through raising the awareness level for people throughout the organization. And the last principle is the data quality is defined and managed consistently across the data lifecycle. So we need to make data governance part of project management no matter what approach we're following to implement projects across the organization. If we're following a traditional waterfall methodology, then what we need to do is we need to apply governance to the steps that we take in the waterfall methodology. The same thing holds true for an agile project. You know, we need to make certain, and this is where a lot of organizations are struggling right now, is to blend data governance with their agile methodology. And so we need to make sure that we make data governance part of project management no matter what approach we're following. If we put governance in place as kind of a reactive issue resolution process, then we need to apply governance to that as well. So what we really need to do is we need to focus on data quality and manage it consistently across the life cycle, whether it's in the definition phase, in the production phase, or the usage phase of data in your organization. So those are the four principles that we talked about, that we need to manage it as an asset, have clearly defined accountability, follow the rules, and be consistent in the way that we do it across the organization. If you remember the graphic that I shared with you a little bit earlier, it also had on the far right side different dimensions that we can use to follow or to measure whether or not we're following the principles. And I'm not going to spend a whole lot of time on these dimensions, but you might want to outline them in your policy. So they are the accessibility to the data, how accurate the data is, which requires that we have standards to compare the data to. You know, completeness of the data, consistency in the data, those are just several of the dimensions that you can use to measure governance. The relevance of the data, the timeliness, and the uniqueness of the data. We know that we need to have ways to be able to measure the things that we put in place around our data governance and around our data governance policy. So again, we have to start with a policy statement. We have core principles that we need our leadership to sign off on, and we need to be able to demonstrate to them that we have a way of being able to measure the success of our program. A couple other things that I've shared in webinars before are messages that I suggest that we share with our management regarding governance. And the first one is that we're already governing data, but the fact is that we're doing it informally. You know, maybe having a data governance policy will really help to formalize the fact that you're governing data. But the fact is that in all those different policies and things that I mentioned earlier, there are levels of governance taking place at your organization. But overall governance is being done typically in a lot of organizations very informally. So I always talk about data governance and data stewardship as going from informal to formal responsibility around data. The second message is we can formalize how we govern data by putting structure around what we're doing. Again, the policy may be the item that will help you to put the structure around how you're going to govern data in your organization. And another message for management is that policy may be necessary to improve whatever it is that is the focus of your data governance program, whether it's managing risk and securing and protecting data, or whether it's improving the quality and the understanding and the usefulness around data across the organization, or even if it's just to improve coordination, cooperation, and communication around data in the organization. We might need in our organization to have a policy that states that these are the things that are necessary for us to move forward. A couple other statements: we don't have to spend a lot of money on data governance. We need structure. You know, we should consider taking a non-invasive approach to how we put governance into place. Now, here's a couple things that you should not tell your leadership about data governance. First of all, don't sell it to them as being this huge, complicated challenge, because in a lot of organizations, it's not. Now, you may be a large organization with people spread out all across the world and there's different business units, but if we are consistent in the way that we document people's relationships to data across those pieces of the organization, it doesn't have to be a huge challenge. Now, emphasize that governance is not a technical solution. Emphasize that you're not really governing the data, you're governing people's behavior associated with that data, and that you can do governance in a evolutionary fashion rather than a revolutionary fashion. So just a couple quick messages of things that we should and shouldn't tell our organizations, tell our management about data governance. All right, so I'm going to again go through a couple different diagrams that I use fairly often and talk about them in terms of using them to support your data governance policy. So I've kind of beat this one up a little bit where we've got the policy statement, we've got the principles, and those are core to being successful with a data governance policy and the ways that we're going to go about measuring the success of the program. Some organizations include in their data governance policy the way that roles and responsibilities are going to be defined for the organization. So if you have a framework or an operating model that defines the different roles associated with data governance in your organization, you might want to include that in your data governance policy. You know, I share this diagram quite often, but the thing that I want to highlight is that a lot of these things already exist in your organization. They're not even new to your organization. Where we really need to focus on are these two areas in the middle of this diagram, the fact that we'll have a council that will resolve issues that get escalated to that level, and that we'll have tactical stewards or domain stewards or enterprise subject matter experts that lie in the middle of this diagram. Now, we want people to understand how data governance is going to work. If that becomes something that you spell out in your data governance policy, then you might want to include your operating model of roles and responsibilities. This is another take on the diagram on the previous slide. If you look at it, it's kind of two triangles instead of the one pyramid diagram. And on the left-hand side, the organization spelled out in their policy the information about their project approach. And then on the right-hand side of the diagram, it talked about the program approach to the roles and responsibilities. So during the project phase, the emphasis is on the executive or strategic level with a further emphasis on tactical, but less so on the operational stewards. But then when we get to the point where the program takes place, the emphasis is on the people that are doing the work, the people that are defining, producing, using data as part of their everyday job. So the emphasis became on the operational roles and then the tactical roles and less so on the executive or strategic roles. So again, another use of a diagram that represents your data governance program that you would incorporate into your data governance policy. I share this diagram all the time. I call it the common data matrix. This is a relatively old version of that diagram, but the truth is that it has remained pretty constant and pretty accessible to organizations across the globe. And it really is an inventory of who does what with data across the organization. So if we agree that our stewards are people that define, produce, and use data as part of their job, we want to know who those people are, and we want to record it somewhere. So the common data matrix is a simple two-dimensional spreadsheet that documents the different domains and subdomains of data across the organization and where that data resides in what systems and who in IT has responsibility for that data as either a data subject matter expert or a system subject matter expert and who in the different parts of the organization define, produce, and use data across the organization. A very simple two-dimensional matrix that helps us to understand that there are multiple people with their hands on different aspects of data across the organization. We need to know who they are if we are going to formalize their accountability. First of all, we've got to define what their clearly defined accountability is, and we've got to communicate it to them. We've got to help them along the way, but how are we going to know who those individuals are? We need to record it somewhere. If we don't use one of the tools that are available on the market to do that, then a simple spreadsheet will be something that's very valuable to you to collect that type of information. All right, so we've kind of beat up policy a little bit. What are some of the things that should be included in policy? I'm going to spend the last couple minutes here talking about procedures. And so because the name of the webinar is Writing Data Governance Policies and Procedures, well, one of the things that I've said often is that I really don't like the term data governance procedures. So my pet peeve is don't call them data governance procedures. Why I added it as the top bullet on this line, on this slide, I don't know. But the fact is I don't like it when we call things data governance procedures because that points at data governance and says data governance is the reason why we are following that procedure. If that is necessary in your organization, go ahead and call it data governance procedures. But the fact is that your request for access to data or your transmitting data to a second party or your handling of data or your printing of data, you know, these are procedures or issue resolution. These are all procedures. We need to apply governance to those procedures. We do not need to label them as data governance procedures. So we could refer to them as procedures that are governed and that we're going to apply governance to procedures. Oftentimes I talk about something that I call the Data Governance Bill of Rights, and that is getting the right person involved at the right time for the right reason, doing the right activity to get the right result, you know, at least most of the time. So if you're interested in a copy of the Bill of Rights, please let me know and I'll be glad to send that to you. But that's really what we're trying to do by applying governance to procedures is get the right person involved at the right time for the right reason, and I'm going to share with you a couple diagrams here in a minute that show how we can do that. So follow the Data Governance Bill of Rights. It really will help you to be successful with your program. We can apply the Data Governance Bill of Rights, and we can apply governance to proactive processes, to reactive processes, and we can use these things that I call governance activity matrices to apply governance to the processes. So let me talk about those more here in a minute. So what are the different types of procedures that are governed data processes? Well, these are processes that most likely already exist in your organization to some degree. Now, there's a data access process, so let's apply governance to that. There's a data issue resolution process, let's apply governance to that. Or there's a data definition production or usage process. Or you do data modeling, or you have big data, so you've got data coming in from everywhere. Or we know that we've got to protect data. You've got processes for doing that. We don't have to call those things data governance processes, but we need to apply governance to them. You know, we follow different project methodologies. We need to retain and eliminate data. We've got processes associated with a lot of different things. One of those things are even having a glossary, dictionary, and data management. And I want to talk a little bit more about that here for a second. So here's an example of something that an organization that I worked with spent a lot of time on. They created three different levels of understanding of their data. They had a vocabulary level, they had a dictionary level, and then they had the physical data level. And they spent a lot of time making sure that the business terms were defined the way that they needed it to be, and that the standard data names and system names were defined. And we had linkages between them. They had all of this information in place to help people to understand and use the data of the organization consistently across the organization. So what was the first thing that they did once we defined this vocabulary and we had these vetted out and approved and agreed upon dictionary, we created a process. I know this is a little bit hard to read, but it's a simple process where somebody makes a request, puts through a form, data governance manager looks at it, bounces it off the steering committee, looks at things that already exist as far as vocabulary terms, make a decision, complete the form, and return it to somebody. It's a simple process that people can follow to make changes to things at the semantic layer, at the business layer, or at the technical layer. But that's a procedure that can be used to support governance in your organization. Other examples real quickly. Here's an example from an organization that selected these six processes as the ones that they wanted to apply governance to. They said they want to resolve or research information quality issues. They want to monitor risk. They want to monitor information quality. All of these things are important to this organization, and they wanted to apply governance to each and every one of these different processes. So how did they go about doing that? And most of you are familiar with things called RACI, or some organizations call it RASCI. Who is responsible? Who's accountable? Who's consulted? Who's informed? Who's supportive? All of those things. So for each and every one of these different processes that they defined, they clearly defined the steps necessary to complete the process, and then they overlaid the different roles that were associated with their program, and they put in a letter as to who is responsible, accountable, consulted, and informed for each of the different steps of the process. That's applying governance to a process, or applying governance to a procedure. Another example of this is an organization that had a system development methodology. These are the different roles associated with governance in their organization, and they're very descriptive as to what each role does during each step of the process. Again, a way of being able to apply governance to the data governance policies and procedures that we're writing or that are going to go alongside the policy in our organization. Another example of the RASCI is for an issue resolution process, the steps that were followed to resolve issues, the different roles associated with the program, neatly color coordinated with the pyramid diagrams. I don't know if you recognize that or not, but if somebody can see themselves on the operating model diagram, they can also see themselves in the activities. I just found it to be a common way, a simple way of being consistent in the way that we communicate things across our organization. Just another example of applying governance to a specific steps of a problem. So the thing that I want to finish up in this webinar with are a couple of different things. We want to answer the question, is a policy necessary for your program? So one of the things that I suggest that you do is evaluate the need for data governance policy versus the examples of data policy that you already have in your organization. Now, one of the things I suggest is that you can leverage that existing policy, and you can even label them as being governance. I'm not saying that you should take credit for them, but what I can say is you can demonstrate to your leadership there is already existing levels of governance in our organization that we have through these policies. Do we need a data governance policy? I don't know. But we can certainly start to leverage things that are in place through existing processes and through existing policies that you have in your organization. And I can almost assure you that you have some hidden somewhere within your organization. They may not be taken off the shelf so that people understand what policies there are and what that means to them, but they're there. Somebody has responsibility for them. Next thing I suggest is build a collection of data governance policies. So different things that are policies, let's build a collection of what those are, and let's kind of represent those things together as having something to do with data governance, but we've already got policy associated with data. Maybe we need something that represents data governance. Maybe we don't. I'm not really certain. It's really a specific answer that would be associated with your organization. You know, build a collection of repeatable procedures that will be governed, whether it is your system development methodology or your issue resolution log, but build a set of repeatable procedures that have governance applied to it and then start to do it. And the easiest way to do that is to recognize what people are presently doing and where they're active in existing processes and just shore that up a little bit rather than saying we're going to redefine all of our processes and all of our procedures as being data governance processes or procedures. So build a collection of policies, build a collection of repeatable procedures, and that will help you. Leverage the model and the matrices and the things that I shared with you in the webinar today and that I've shared with you in other webinars, you know, as part of your policy. If you need to be able to describe your roles and responsibilities or how there is shared ownership and leadership of data across the organization, use the tools that I shared with you and make them custom to your organization, but leverage them as part of your policies that you put into place. And leverage the models and the matrices to apply governance to processes. Use those cross-reference tools that I shared with you, the things that I call governance activity matrices, to help to understand who does what in different steps of the processes that you are governing. Just as a quick reminder here, and then Eric, I'm going to turn it back over to you to see if we have any questions and answers, or we have any questions, and then I'll be glad to provide answers.
But we have a lot of questions, Bob.
So as a reminder is, you know, the next webinar is the third Thursday in March. We've talked about a couple things in this webinar. I appreciate your interest. And with that, you know, let's do it with the questions, Eric.
All right. So one housekeeping item here, several people have asked if they could get a copy of the Bill of Rights somehow. How would they go about doing that? Is that something we can share?
You know what it is, and I think it's something that Shannon has gotten used to attaching to the follow-up email for the people that have attended the webinar. So if it's not there, then I will make sure that it is there. And so there's a couple different versions of that. There's also an article out on TDAN about the Data Governance Bill of Rights if you want quick access to it. I also have a handy-dandy poster that you can print of the Bill of Rights. It's not that handy and not that dandy, but, you know, it is a poster that outlines that. But, yeah, the Data Governance Bill of Rights are out there and accessible. If you can't get them, then request them from me, and I will get them to you.
Okay, will do. The first question we got was, how do you define a data governance policy document as opposed to a data governance standard document?
Data governance standards. I'm not sure that there really would be a difference between those two. I mean, I have never really referred to it as a data governance standards document. I've heard of data quality standards and standards for data, like data naming and data usage and those types of things. But I haven't really heard of things that are referred to as data governance standards. And I have seen them referred to as policies and guidelines. So if you want to talk a little bit more about what a data governance standard is, the person who asked that question, you know, please reach out to me. I'd love to talk to you about that.
Okay. What top 2 to 3 techniques do you use to be less invasive?
Well, the first one is very easy. It is rather than assigning people to be stewards. You know, my suggestion always was that we would identify people and their relationship to the data, and then they became stewards. But really, it's even better than that. I was doing work for a government agency that said, we need to recognize people as being stewards. So that has a positive connotation that goes with it. So one of the first things that I suggested, to be non-invasive, let's not assign people to be stewards. Let's identify and recognize them. Another thing that I suggest is that we get a thorough understanding of where people are spending their time and their relationship to the data and the pain points that they have associated with the data. And we address those types of things and make sure that they are participating in the definition of the program. You know, a third thing, just to grab a third thing real quickly, that operating model of roles and responsibilities, you know, my suggestion is, is don't try to plug your organization into that operating model. actually use that operating model and overlay it over your present organization, because you're going to see that you already have operational, tactical, strategic, executive, and supporting roles. So again, if we can see what people are doing in the roles that we're defining as part of our program, that really helps you to be non-invasive, because it doesn't feel to the people that now have some formal accountability. Oh, by the way, they had accountability before, it just wasn't formal. But if we go about that approach, then they're not going to feel like you're giving them a heck of a lot more than they presently have. So it'll be less threatening to them. It'll be less invasive to what they do. So those are three, and I'm sure there are a lot more that would describe how being non-invasive is going to add value to your program.
Okay, next question. How often are data governance policies woven into HR policies?
Ooh, good one. I think data governance policy would be woven into HR. If you have a data governance policy, it would be woven into HR activities the same way any of your other policies are. So if you have somebody who is new to the company coming in, or you have somebody who is signing their employee handbook every year to say that they understand the policies, that they're going to follow the policies, I would intertwine the data governance policy within that set of policies, whether it's the orientation level that you give somebody when they join the company, or whether it's somebody, you know, or whether it's through some type of education that you have. But I wouldn't make such a big thing out of data governance policy. It's just another policy that is required and that people need to be educated about. But if you're already educating them in protection and security and other things, then leverage the same format that you use for that to kind of intertwine data governance policy in HR activities.
Okay. Well, the next question was actually phrased as a statement, but I think there's a really interesting nuance in here worth asking you to address. In order to get upper management buy-in that such an adventure needs to be taken, I would need to explain to them what data as an asset really means. They think that they do treat it as an asset because we enforce a high level of security. Do you want to address that?
Yeah, I do. I think that's a great statement. And, you know, that's a true statement. To some degree, they do manage it as an asset. You know, they do secure the data, and in most organizations, if they're not protecting the data yet, they are going to protect the data. The problem is that the aspects of the asset that are not governed are the definition of the data. For that, as an example. So if you have the same data defined multiple different ways in multiple parts of your organization, and you allow that practice to continue, you're not governing your data effectively from a definition perspective. If the people that are entering the data don't understand how that data is going to be used and why that data is necessary, then you're not going to be successful in the program. So you know, you've got to convince your senior leadership that you're already governing data as an asset to a degree, but we're not governing it formally in all aspects of it. You know, securing the data is just one aspect of it. Hopefully you're doing a good job of doing that. But there are the other aspects that we spoke about today even, you know, that need to be governed as well. It's not just a security thing.
All right. We have time for maybe one or two more. We have identified hundreds of data groups. We have the definitions and the rules. How do we manage these?
Yeah, the definitions and the rules. Well, that's a good question, though. It is, really, because, you know what, it's good to have those things defined. And having those things defined actually put you ahead of many organizations that don't have those things defined. So what you need to do is you need to communicate those effectively to people. And you need to communicate to them that we do have a standard definition and we do have standard rules associated with that data. So, you know, it really becomes something that we need to make certain that people understand that, you know, not only is data an asset, but it touches each, it has something to do with everything that we as an organization do. You know, even if we sell the world's greatest widgets, you know, there are materials that make up those widgets. We have customers that we sell those widgets to. We've got people in the organization. You know, we've got to govern each and every one of those aspects of it. So, I think it's a good statement, but it's you know, we got to take it beyond.
Yeah. All right, last question. How do we manage data standards documents? Are there data rules engines out there that we can use?
I think there are. I think there are tools that you can specifically use to manage those rules, that you can use to govern the rules, get the appropriate people involved in the rules. You know, once you have the rules defined, the way to approach it in the organization is to educate people. So first of all, don't hand them a set of rules it's unlikely that they're going to follow. You know, give them, again, something that's digestible for them, help them to understand it, and communicate it to them and get them to live it as part of their everyday life. So the more and more that the people become aware of their relationship to the data and the need to steward that relationship to the data, whether it's definition or production or usage, the better off you're going to be with your data governance program. So those are a lot of questions, really good questions, Eric.
Well, thank you to our audience for posting those. Thank you, Bob, for this great presentation and Q&A. I'm afraid that is all the time we have for today. Just to remind everyone, we will post the recorded webinar and the slide deck to dataversity.net within 2 business days, and all registrants of today's webinar will receive a follow-up email to let you know the links and other requested information. Don't forget that you can meet Bob in person at Enterprise Data World 2016 in San Diego, California. I will be there as well. Looking forward to seeing you, Bob. That takes place April 17th through 22nd. Just go to enterprisedataworld.com for more information. Thank you again for attending today's webinar, everyone, and I hope you have a great day.
Thank you very much, Eric. Look forward to working with you again.
You too, Bob.
Take care. Bye.